That is the melody for the verse. Yeah, it's a Christmas song. But so what do you think to go into that? Because all I played was the...
Just for Sam.
Oh, I'm sorry. No.
When I did the organ part, I didn't realize they had a tag on the end of it. And for... How Firm a Foundation...
Oh, okay.
There's the continuation of it. It repeats the other the phrase again. We just cut it off.
Okay. So you're going to do the tag?
We are going to do the tag.
Okay.
Well, I mean, the
great
thing is
still
somehow
I've. So I've got it for the ladies also.
I didn't even know. I didn't think about it.
Time in.
Thank you. So yeah, what do you think of that? All I'm playing is the one thing. And I think I threw a 6
You guys know what I think about?
Yeah, because I have a kind of like a I thought of it.
So you're thinking I should walk into a chord progression or just
3-7-1 I think is what they're on now.
But still, I think, like you said,
okay.
You could throw it, if you write out the melody,
okay, I can do that.
Then that would be a whole lot easier.
Yeah. But do you like the melody?
Well, yeah, it sounds very helpful, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Is that just the second part?
Yeah, but that's
what I do.
It's not born in a manger. Jesus decides here. The rhythm for this, David, is it? Sorry, I got to fix
something. Off screen.
It's not off screen.
Oh, yeah, I remember the whole bill.
But, yeah. Do you do lyrics too?
No. I mean, I've never really tried that much, to be honest.
Really? I bet you'd be good. You've been around enough good stuff.
Yeah,
you know what's good and
what's
bad.
Yeah, I know. I could probably do some. Seems like I did. Were you here last time? Did you come that last competition? I did. The one where I did that. You were here last time.
Yeah.
Okay. The one after that, I brought.
You're not?
No. we left Oak Park. Pretty much just, we kind of, well, not kind of, about, we about let
I'm going to... I'm going to read a scripture right before, a short scripture right before we begin the whole thing. So, and I'll read it from this mic. All right, thank you.
Well, look, I'm about to leave. I'm about to
it's growing out. It's pretty. Really, it gets to like a weird in between, and then it turns into a new haircut.
Yeah, so I've got to retrain my hair. Which way to fall?
Well, I've been going through that for about a week and a half, and I just figured out last night how to fix it on. Just, it's a little high maintenance every once in a while.
I know how that feels.
My friend died.
A mighty fortress. Jason, measure measure 59. Bump. A mighty fortress. A mighty fortress. And then I want to get this transition into how firm a foundation. Two, three, and four, and yeah.
A mighty fortress is a soprano.
Go for it.
I mean, if you look at somebody, I mean, if you look at somebody,
Thank you. scripture we're coming in? Yeah, right after, like after Dr. Kelly.
Let's lift our hearts to the Lord this morning. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield, the horn of my salvation. He is my stronghold, my refuge, and my Savior. I call to the Lord who is worthy of praise and have been saved from mine enemies.
Thank you.
moment for prayer. Oh, Father, we thank you for the rich promises that we know are true, that we have been singing to you so far in this time of worship. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you have revealed yourself to us, and you continue to speak to our hearts and change our lives each and every day. Lord, we pray that as we move towards the end of this semester, God, that you would give us strength, that you would give us endurance. We thank you that you are our foundation, and that you are that stronghold, Lord. You are the one on whom we can stand, on whom we can build our lives, and you are the one to whom we can flee. Lord, we can flee to you when times are tough. We can flee to you when times are great, God, but praise you that we can flee to you. God, our prayer is that during this time that we have set aside just to worship you, to sing to you, to hear from you through your word, God, I pray that you would move among us. I pray, Lord, that you would speak to us. I pray that you would refresh us. I pray that you would give us peace and give us rest. And Lord, we know that that only truly comes through and from you. We thank you for who you are today. And it is our privilege to worship you, God. Thank you for being with us, Lord. And we pray that you would continue to lead us now as we worship you. Continue to speak, Lord. Continue to move. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much. You can be seated. I want to welcome you to chapel. Isn't it great just to worship God as the semester is somewhat too rapidly drawing to a close? But just to take some time out of our day and out of our week to worship God together as a seminary family. We're grateful to be able to do that, grateful for today and the opportunity that we have to worship God through music, and we're thankful for Dr. Farrington leading us in worship through music, and also our preacher for the day. We're grateful for who he is, how God has blessed him so far, and we look forward to hearing from him. Our preacher for the day is Dr. Reggie Bridges. After graduating from Blue Mountain College, he came to New Orleans Seminary, and he got two masters and a PhD. And it's a good reminder to you also that you will finish at some point. Hopefully, you will finish at some point. That's certainly our goal for you. But Reggie has pastored in Mississippi, pastored in Louisiana. He is now at Temple Baptist Church in Ruston, Louisiana. And he also is accompanied by his wife, Leslie. It's great to have you, Leslie. They have four children. And just like so many of us, Reggie outpunted his coverage. He married way above him, above himself. But I think he would probably agree with that, as most of us would. And most of us should, by the way, recognize that. If you're smart, you will. But we are grateful for Reggie and his ministry. Reggie is a great pastor. Reggie is a great preacher. He loves to preach God's word, and he loves to preach God's word to his people, to his church, and to see God move and change lives through the proclamation of the word and through the work of the pastor. So I know that God will speak to your heart through Reggie today, and we look forward to that time. Before continuing to worship God through music, as we always do on Tuesday and Thursday, we want to take a portion of God's word and read it together, aloud as a seminary family. So I want to invite you to stand as Keith Taylor, a PhD student in preaching, comes and reads God's word. He'll be reading from Psalm 100 this morning.
A psalm of thanksgiving. Shout triumphantly to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Acknowledge that the Lord is God. He made us, and we are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name, for the Lord is good and his love is eternal. His faithfulness endures through all generations.
I have been in his past, I hope for years to come. And that is our battle cry, that Jesus saves. What a great, great opportunity it is for me to be here. I am thankful for the invitation from Dr. Newsom, Brother Blake, appreciate you, and Dr. Kelly and the others who allowed me to come and be here today. This is the first time that I have spoken in chapel since I graduated some time ago, and it is a rather emotional experience. When you come back to this place after you had studied here on this campus and after you had gone through all the things the professors make you go through in order to get a degree, and then come back and be able to address the chapel service, it's rather emotional. Even to look down and see my fellow brother from Blue Mountain College, Brother Jake, Dr. Rukowski, he and I don't have quite the same accent, but we have similar DNA coming from Blue Mountain and then here at New Orleans. And I'm thankful to be here with you today. I'm going to share God's word with you. If you'll take your Bible and turn to 2 Kings chapter 6. 2 Kings chapter 6. I have two purposes today. One, obviously, to come and to preach and to share God's word with you and hopefully encourage you today. The other, I have come to make sure that two of your faculty members are doing what they are supposed to do, and also that they're coming home for the holidays. Because you may not know this, but I pastor Dr. Lemke's mother, and I pastor Dr. Farrington's parents, mother and dad. So I have some influence over them. If you would like to talk to me afterwards, I promise you I can make some things happen in their lives by talking to their parents. But they wanted me to come down on a scouting trip and see their children and see when things were going to take place and if they're coming home and if they're doing what they're supposed to. So I'll try to go back and I'll try to report accordingly, okay? But also, I've come to be able to hopefully share with you just a message. And you know, as you approach these moments, for me, I wrestle with what God would have you to say or what He would have me to say. A lot of times God leads me through books of the Bible to preach on Sunday mornings or Sunday nights. But then when you're called to ask to speak at a specific moment, at a specific time, you wrestle with it because you think to yourself, you may never get another chance to come back. And what all should you say? And I really have put a time of prayer and a time of reflection into this. And you know, as God continued to speak to me in the last few weeks, as I continue to read through the scripture, it just kept coming back, this message of encouragement. This message of encouragement. And I want to encourage you, and perhaps maybe the reason God has placed this upon my heart is for such a time as this. Obviously, this moment in the semester, I was being reminded a moment ago, I had forgotten about those moments of the semester, but I was reminded a few moments ago by Brother Blake about how this is a grueling time. The papers are coming due, the exams are going to come around, you're finishing out. Maybe that's the time of encouragement that you need in your life. Maybe it's this word. And I want you to see, as we look at the life and the ministry of Elisha, how he brought encouragement to those who were around him, and how God reflected his power in both the small things and the big things. Notice it says in verse 1 of 2 Kings chapter 6, "And the sons of the prophets said to Elisha, 'See now, the place where we dwell with you is too small for us. Please let us go to the Jordan, and let every man take a beam from there, and let us make there a place where we may dwell.' So he answered, 'Go.' And then one said, 'Please consent to go with your servants.' And he answered, 'I will go.' So he went with them, and when they came to the Jordan, they cut down trees. But as one was cutting down a tree, the iron axe head fell into the water, and he cried out and said, 'Alas, my master, for it was borrowed.' So the man of God said, 'Where did it fall?' And he showed him the place. So he cut off a stick and threw it in there, and he made the iron float. Therefore, he said, 'Pick it up for yourself.' And so he reached out his hand and took it." Now, again, the life and the ministry of Elisha. He continued on the power and the work of his mentor Elijah, and he was continuing to pour into those other prophets, those other sons of the prophets who were coming along, those other students, if you will. You know, I did a study recently on the life of Elijah and the life of Elisha. I kind of took both of those characters of the scripture and I preached through those passages related to them on Wednesday night. It took me a long time. I've just celebrated almost a year at Temple Baptist Church in Ruston. And it took me almost that whole time on Wednesday nights to teach through that and preach about those individuals. But one of the things that I noted, that I don't think I'd ever noted before, is that there were these little like schools, seminaries, if you will, those places where the sons of the prophets were being trained. You'll remember if you go back and look at Elijah's life that there in his farewell tour, before God called him home, he visited Bethel and Gilgal and Jericho because those were the centers of activity of those sons of the prophets studying. And he went through each one. And now you see Elisha has taken up the mantle literally of Elijah, and he is also mentoring those young students. And here in verse 1 it says that there comes a time where they need to expand. They need to enter into a building program of the church, if you will, or of the seminary. And they said, we've got to find another place to live. Obviously, there was some type of communal living that the sons of the prophets experienced while still retaining their privileges and their rights with their families. And they said, we've got to have another place. Can we move on down by the Jordan? And Elisha, we want you to go with us. So Elisha agrees and says, we're going to go down, we're going to build this, and I'm going to be there with you, and I'm going down. And it says, in the midst of that, while they are knocking down trees and they're cutting up things, it says that this one seminary student, this son of the prophet, that he drops, he loses this iron axe head. And notice his response. Alas, master, for it was borrowed. He says, I can't believe I've done this. I've dropped the axe head. It was borrowed. Now, understand my Hebrew is somewhat limited. Dr. Cole did everything he could with me, but it's still limited somewhat. But I went back and I tried to look at that word borrowed, and it seems to communicate more than just a simple going and saying, hey, could you loan me that iron axe head? Could you do that? It seemed to be more than that that's communicated in this Hebrew term. It actually speaks about going and almost like begging, asking, saying, hey, would you let me borrow your iron axe head? And you know you have to beg sometimes as a seminary student, right? I mean, you don't have a whole lot to put up, or I didn't necessarily, And they go and they say, would you let me borrow the iron axe head? And then he drops it. That which he begged for, that which he asked for, he finally prevailed upon that neighbor, the neighbor that would never loan him anything. He finally prevailed upon him. And he dropped it. And of course, that iron axe head was so valuable. And as you think about that young son of the prophet, as you think about his lack of resources, as you think about how he would struggle with paying that back, perhaps coming under a debt that he could never repay, he expressed his anguish. Alas, master. And it says in verse 6, so the man of God said, where did it fall? Now, I'm struck by this. That Elisha, the man of God, representing God's presence to the sons of the prophets, that he would show such concern for this young seminary student. I'm struck by it. I've always been thankful for those professors that really demonstrated their concern and their compassion for me, but You know, I'm struck by it always because it seems to be such a small thing. Why in the world would they be concerned about just an iron axe head falling for Elisha? I understand why the seminary student is concerned. He can't pay it back. He's going to be under this crushing debt. But Elisha shows concern. Where did it fall? Where did it fall? And you know what I've seen in my ministry in my life? Is that God himself is concerned about even the small things of our lives. I mean, an iron axe head falling, how does that contribute to the kingdom of God? I mean, how does it fit into these great purposes that God has? Shouldn't we just move on and talk about some other experiences in 2 Kings? Why do we have to dwell here on this iron axe head and how the concern that Elisha shows? I think it reminds us that God is concerned about the small things of our lives. And God has a way of providing for those small things. One thing that I've been struck about in Elijah and Elisha's ministries is that they were very personal. They were able to touch individuals. They were able to minister to them. Even back in chapter 4, for Elisha, he had multiplied the oil for the widow. He had purified that poisonous pot of stew. He had fed the 100. All cases of somehow Elisha, as he demonstrated the power of God, providing for those small things of life. I remember when Leslie and I were preparing to move to seminary. I originally grew up around Tupelo, Mississippi. I went to Blue Mountain College and pastored a small church there in the last year or so of my college experience. And Leslie and I were getting ready to come to New Orleans. I knew for many, many, many years that this would be the place I would go and do my grad study. I really never had much of a doubt about it. I knew I was coming to New Orleans because it is the only choice, right? I remind my staff of that often. All these other, anyway. We were coming down, and I was going to resign my church. Leslie, thankfully, had finished her teaching degree, and she was going to teach, and she was, thank God for those wives that put us seminary boys through school, because she was going to teach, and I could study, but we were getting ready to move. We didn't know much about New Orleans. I'd only been here once, and we were struggling with the possibility of what we were going to do and where we were going to live. Well, we decided, because Leslie needed to teach in the state of Mississippi because of her scholarship obligations and requirements, that we would try to live in the state of Mississippi. I wanted her to be able to kind of teach and not have to drive too far, and then I would just drive into the seminary. So I went to a map, okay? I'm not very familiar with South Mississippi. Understand, again, I'm from North Mississippi, so I'm not familiar with a lot of things in life, okay? I looked at the map, and I looked, and I said, you know, Picayune, that's about as close as you can get to the seminary and stay in the state of Mississippi. So I said, and I hate to tell you, I wished I could tell you it was more spiritual or so. I just said, we're going to Picayune. That next week, I saw my director of missions, and I told Bill. I said, Bill, I'm going to seminary. I'm leaving Canaan. And he said, you are? Where are you going to live? And I said, well, we're thinking about this place called Picayune. And he said, well, you know what? The pastor that's there at First Baptist, Dr. Bill Harden, he used to be the pastor at Ripley, and you ought to get with him. I came down, spent that day with Dr. Harden. He took off the whole day to drive me around Picayune and find me a place to stay. Leslie had interviewed that day with the school board. Looking back, looking back over these years, I recognize that even in the small things, even in my housing, even in our job situation, that God was showing his concern and his love and his compassion. Isn't that awesome? Isn't it awesome that he is concerned about an iron axe head that falls? When he recognizes it could bring you under such crushing debt, God understands. So, verse 6, the man of God, after saying, where did it fall? He and the student showing him the place. Elisha cut off a stick and threw it in there. Okay, some people have tried to say he just went and dug around and tried to find it a little bit. The wording here is that he threw the stick into the water. And you know what happens? It always happens like this, right? A stick goes in, the iron axe head floats up. I mean, wood always attracts metal or iron. And this is what happens. Because get this. God often takes our accidents, our perceived accidents, and he uses them to demonstrate his power. Amen. Know that the son of the prophet had not intentionally dropped that axe head. He had not intentionally done that. He didn't say, hey guys, let's throw the iron axe head over there and let's see if old Professor Elisha can do something about it. He didn't try to devise some plan so that the power of God would be just. He just simply dropped it. And there are moments in our lives where we simply just drop the axe. And unfortunately, there have been moments even in my ministry where I dropped the axe. But what I have seen is that God has such redeeming power that he can take those accidents, he can take those dropped axes, and what he can do is demonstrate his glory. A God who's concerned about the small things. Well, I could certainly end the message there, but I have a few more minutes. And Blake has not told me he was going to invite me back yet. So, let me just show you something that stands in contrast, but which complements this narrative as well. Okay? Verse 8. Now the king of Syria was making war against Israel, and he consulted with his servants, saying, my camp will be in such and such a place. And the man of God sent to the king of Israel, saying, beware that you do not pass this place, for the Syrians are coming down there. Then the king of Israel sent someone to the place of which the man of God had told him. Thus he warned him, and he was watchful there, not just once or twice. Therefore the heart of the king of Syria was greatly troubled by this thing. And he called his servants and said to them, will you not show me which of us is for the king of Israel? So all of a sudden, you move from this story of the iron axe head, you move right into this narrative about how the Syrians and the nation of Israel, how they were continuing to experience tension and conflict, and how the Syrians were sending in these raiding armies into Israel. You launch right into that story. And it says that the king of Syria was frustrated. He says, it seems like every time we get our plans together and we have everything devised, it seems like they know what's coming. We've got a traitor in our midst. Verse 12. And one of his servants said, none, my lord, O king, but Elisha, the prophet who is in Israel, tells the king of Israel the words that you speak in your bedroom. It's not one of us. Not the servants, it is Elisha, the man of God. And he knows the things that you're devising, the plans, the strategy. It's as though he has your bedroom bugged. Now, Brother Blake mentioned a moment ago that I have four children. Their ages are 11, 9, 6, and about to be 3. We have an active household. It's an awesome thing to be a parent. It is a busy and exhausting thing to be a parent. So a lot of times when we have finished our day and we'll be crawling into bed and turn on the television or so, as much as I love my wife, Leslie, she wants to talk about the things of the day. Why? Because that's the only quiet moment we've had. And she'll want to talk, and sometimes I want to, but she'll talk, and we can say things like, did you see the grade that they made on their test today? Did you hear what they said? Are our kids going to be okay? Are they going to be fine? We would never say that in front of our children. And thankfully, they'll never have access to this chapel service. But we talk about things that we wouldn't talk about otherwise. And now, basically, what he says is in that most intimate area, he says, those things that are significant and secretive that you would speak in your bedroom, it's like Elisha knows those things. So, verse 13, he said, go and see where he is, and I may send and get him. And it was told him, saying, surely he is in Dothan. Verse 14, therefore he sent horses and chariots and a great army there, and there came by night and surrounded the city. How many guys are they going after? One. And yet the pagan king says, what we need to do is get the greatest army we can find, get the horses, get the chariots. We got to go get this guy. Isn't it amazing that a pagan king can recognize the power of God? Isn't it awesome that the pagan king of Syria can stand in awe of the power of Israel's God because of what they've seen? Sometimes I think the pagans, I think they have more faith in God's power than we do. Especially as you continue to read the story, as the servant utters his faithlessness. He said, verse 15, when the servant of the man of God arose early and went on, there was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots. And his servant said to him, alas, my master, what shall we do? Probably one of those great understatements of Scripture. I mean, you look out, you see the great army, you see all the people. What are we going to do? Verse 16, so he answered one of the most beautiful phrases in all of our Scripture, do not fear. For those who are with us are more than those who are with them. And Elisha prayed and said, Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may see. Then the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. Because get this, the God that we serve, he is interested in the small things, but he's also in control of the big things. Yes, he is concerned about the seminary student, but at the same time, he is working in his providential way for his greater kingdom, and here in this case, for the nation. And he says, Elisha, he prays that God would open the eyes of the servant and that he would be able to see that there were more on their side than on the enemy's side. I want to be honest with you. I know I'm a pastor. I know I've been to seminary. I know that I have sat through the Doctrine of God seminar under Dr. Lemke and Dr. Stewart. I know how great our God is. I know all of the
I know all of those theological truths of God's sovereignty. But I must admit to you, there are days when I am overwhelmed. When I turn on my television and I see beheadings and bombings, when I see the pain and the struggle of people who are living right here in our own state, I am overwhelmed. And I will tell you, at least just for a moment, it seems that the enemy is advancing. And that's when I pray, God, give me vision. Vision to be able to see that there are more on our side than on theirs. God, remind me that greater is he that is in us than he that is in this world. His eyes were open. Verse 18 says, and when the Syrians came down to him, Elisha prayed to the Lord and said, strike this people, I pray, with blindness. Notice the interplay between sight and blindness here. He says, strike them with blindness. And he struck them with blindness according to the word of Elisha. Now Elisha said to them, this is not the way, nor is the city. Follow me, and I will bring you to the man whom you seek. But he led them to Samaria. Now, my math is probably not the best either. You wonder now, how in the world did I even get a degree? But being in Mississippi, my math's not the best. But I tried to figure it up. It said, basically, my understanding here is that they marched them 12 miles. 12 miles. This great army, the army that was coming to pursue and capture one man. Now, through the power of God, one man has led the captives 12 miles into the heart of the nation, into Samaria. And so it was when they had come to Samaria that Elisha said, Lord, open the eyes of these men that they may see. And the Lord opened their eyes, and they saw, and there they were inside Samaria. Now when the king of Israel saw them, he said to Elisha, my father, shall I kill them? Shall I kill them? But he answered, you should not kill them. Would you kill those whom you have taken captive with your sword and your bow? Set food and water before them that they may eat and drink and go to their master. Then he prepared a great feast for them, and after they ate and drank, he sent them away, and they went to their master. So the bands of Syrian raiders came no more into the land of Israel. Some of you probably say, why in the world again would you cover all of these verses? Reggie, it would have been just as good for you to stop with the story of the iron axe head. Why would you, or even just do this one, the story of these Syrians who have been captured. Why would you do both? See, this is what you got to love about Scripture, okay? It's God, through his Holy Spirit, as he was directing the thoughts and the mind and the hand of the writer, placed these two narratives together. And in some ways they do contrast, because you have the small thing, the seminary student, the basic needs that he has, and then you have the bigger thing, the national interest, God working in his people. There's a contrast. But also, don't you see how these two different narratives form one true story, how they complement one another, and how they speak to a God who is concerned about the small needs, and a God who is concerned about the bigger needs? For you see, whether it's the need of the seminary student, or it's the interest of the nation. God is actively engaged in human history to display his glory. That's what I see in the scripture. And I say to you today, wherever you are, maybe it's just a paper you've got to complete. Maybe it's something small like that. Maybe it's a bill that you've got to find the resources to pay. Today, God is attentive to the seminary student. He's attentive to all of our needs. And maybe that's where you are. And that's the word God has for you, that word of encouragement. Some of you, you may be like me in those days past of where I just look at the whole grand scheme and see the things that are being accomplished or not accomplished and thinking, how in the world can we advance against such darkness? And maybe today what you need to hear, greater is he that's in you than he that's in this world. And while it may seem that the forces of darkness, Satan himself, are advancing, I guarantee you that the power of God will show itself, and God himself will demonstrate the true victory as he accomplishes his will and his purpose. He cares for you in the small. He cares for us in the big. Would you hear God's word? And would you let him minister to you today? Let's pray. Father, thank you for this tremendous opportunity to open your word. Oh God, how instructive, how encouraging it is to us as your people. And God, there are some of us in this place today. Lord, we are dealing with what many would consider the small things of life. But God, we know you're concerned. And we pray that even when we drop the axe, that Lord, you would use it as an opportunity to demonstrate your power and your glory in our lives and through our lives. And Father, today, as we go from this place, as you call us each and every day to be the witnesses of your Son, the Lord Jesus, would you give us that sense of power and that sense of strength? May we know that the Holy Spirit's dynamic working in our lives, Lord, will continue to fulfill your purpose and your will. We commit this to you this morning. We give thanks to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good.